Okay, so we have a really good friend that's a great pilot, Captain Brent. We took his huge plane. Well, not really. It held four of us, barely. And he flew us up to Sonoma. The Great Pumpkin.
That was valet parking.
I had my trusty boater bag, thank God. And off we went. What a view. It's impossible to describe. We landed at the Charles Schulz Airport in Santa Rosa. Yeah, Charles Schulz, the guy who drew the Peanuts game. Kinda cool. The airport logo is Snoopy as the Red Baron. Anyway, it was quite an adventure. This is such a beautiful area. But enough of my yakking. Sit back and enjoy.
Welcome to The Wine Dude, Tasting As You Go, a podcast for those excited about wine tasting but too poor to be a snob. We're here at Ravenswood Winery up in Sonoma Valley. Beautiful place. All kinds of trees and flowers and vineyards, eucalyptus trees, all kinds of neat stuff. This is a very old winery. It's been here about 30 years, and I got some great Zinfandels here. So, why don't you come with me as we go in with the Wine Dude, Tasting As You Go. We're up here at Ravenswood Winery. Beautiful. We're here with Bruce McKay, the Visitor Center Manager, right?
Correct.
Yes. Right. That took me a while to get. How you doing?
I'm doing good, and welcome to Ravenswood.
Yeah, it's really nice up here. I love your winery.
It's a gorgeous day. It's just right for wine tasting.
Well, we're standing out here in front of this sign, a tombstone you called it?
This is sort of very significant in our history. We started out in 1976, so this is our 30th anniversary. And we are known for big, bold wines. Our motto is no wimpy wines.
No wimpy wines?
I'm sure you've seen that everywhere.
Let me five on that. No wimpy wines.
And it's translated into many languages. In Spanish, it's no vino sin huevos, so it's a little edgy, but that's what we are. We make serious wines, but we're very irreverent in how we go about it. The tribute, as you can see here, says, to air is human, but to Zin is divine, and here lies the last wimpy wine, R.I.P. And White Zinfandel, which is still a very popular wine, we consider to be a wimpy wine. There's one buried down below. So this is our little tribute to wimpy wines, because we don't make those.
Oh, I love this. This is great. Yeah. I totally agree. So where are we going now?
We're going into the barrel room. These are all these single vineyard designate wines. And these are the 2005 vintage wines that went into barrel last October. So I'd like you to try some samples of those.
Oh, so samples out of the barrel?
Out of the barrel.
Okay, I guess I can do that.
You can do that?
Yeah.
And I'd like you to introduce you to Peter Griffith.
Peter Griffith.
Wine Dude.
How are you?
Nice to meet you. Thank you. We're going to taste some barrel samples. And what I brought you here is we've got vineyards all over the county, but we've also got some soil samples here from some of our vineyards. We talk about terroir, the effect of soil, climate, topography on our wine. And people know what climate is, they know what topography is, but they don't usually think of dirt this way. And it's pretty enlightening. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be tasting the Cook Vineyard, the Bologna Vineyard, which I don't have, but the Barisha Vineyard. And what's kind of neat about this is here's the Cook Vineyard. This is all volcanic ash, solid rock. Here's an example of it. This is all the stuff that blows out of the volcano before the basalt flows out.
Okay.
Now, we've got a lot of this through the county, and what's interesting is Charlie's property, the soil horizons goes between about 6 inches and about 39 inches. It's real interesting. It's a neat vineyard because the vines are about 20 years old, but they look like they're about 3 years old.
Oh, wow.
And the fruit that comes out is just really intense, and it's really a good wine.
And that's because the volcanic provides real good, what, drainage and...
Well, it's actually kind of the opposite of that. The soil's pretty dead, and it doesn't have a lot of nutrients in it. And if you look at the ag reports for the county, you can't raise cattle up there or any sheep or anything.
Huh.
So Charlie's kind of a unique individual and put a vineyard up there anyways.
Okay. Who's Charlie?
Charlie Cook.
Charlie Cook.
Charlie okay. Cook. He's quite a historic character. Charlie was actually accused by Nixon as being Deep Throat.
Really?
Yeah. On the Nixon tapes, Kissinger and Nixon are talking, and they refer to Charlie as being one of the suspects for Deep Throat. He worked for the Pentagon, and he did give information to Ellsberg, but it was not the information he was accused of.
Okay. So he gets to keep his winery, right?
We do. The other wine we're going to be tasting is Barishia, and this is in the Sonoma Valley. Let's just go over and taste the wines and talk about them.
Okay.
You want to?
Sure.
All right, cool. We got to get some glasses.
Glasses? Oh, we're not going to just sip it right out of the barrel?
Well, this is a wine bong.
Did you just say wine bong?
Yes.
God, I've been hearing that all day. Why does everybody keep saying that? Okay, Peter, we're out here. Wait.
Yes?
What's this called?
That's called a bung.
A bung, and this here?
Is a bung hole.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Proceed.
All right. What we're going to do is we're going to taste some of the cook. This is an 05, so this is still a baby. It's going to spend 2 years in the barrel.
Okay.
This will give you a little glimpse of where the wine starts. So, yeah, this is an absolutely incredible wine.
I heard you do quite a few Zins.
15.
15. So which one's this?
This is the Cook Zinfandel. This is coming from the hills above Sonoma.
So this is from that ashy sand that you were just showing me.
Exactly. We get about 300 cases out of this vineyard.
Very nice.
Yeah, this is one of the really nice ones.
I've had Ravenswood before, and I thought it was a great thing because I love the Zin that I'm having. But I'm hearing from you guys, that's just the stuff that you let go into the stores. So we're really glad we're up here now.
Well, it's nice to have you here.
That's good.
It's pretty tasty.
Yeah, definitely. How long has that been there?
Probably about 4 months.
4 months?
Yeah, it's going to do 2 years.
Wow.
It's fun to watch this day after day. We taste out of here, and we get to watch this mature, and it's quite a privilege.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
And do you, once it's in the bottle, how long does it, you know, how long before it hits its optimum point? About.
Well, these will lay down 7 to 10 years. I mean, there's variations. We've seen some of Joel's Zins go out 15 years, and they're just delicious. It depends on the vintage and the wine.
Okay.
But generally about 7 to 10 years, or optimal about 7 to 8 years.
Yeah, so we were told, of course, buy several, like maybe one every couple months to see how it goes up to 7 to 10 years.
I think one a day.
One a day?
Yeah.
I like the way you think.
Resveratrol, my friend. Damn big Barishia.
Poor guy has so much to choose from, he doesn't know which one to do. Oh, boy.
Choices.
Someone's got to do it.
So this is the Barishia. This is Sonoma Valley. This was planted up in the early 1890s. This vineyard, interestingly enough, was at one time owned by a guy named Joe Hooker.
Really?
Yep. And his legacy stays in the English language today.
Yeah.
What's interesting is we've got...
Tasting that wine, my friend.
What's interesting is we've got two Zins. Two different areas, two completely different wines.
Totally different tastes.
Yeah. As with, combined with the soil samples, people start to see the effect of terroir.
Oh, absolutely. We're seeing that a lot up here.
Yeah.
Where it goes, it's just so different depending on where those grapes are grown.
Exactly, what kind of soil they're in.
Yeah.
It's really neat.
It is, it's quite neat. I love it.
That's great. So you're gonna go down and taste some of the finished wines.
Okay, compared to these. Are these same ones? Oh, no, because these are still in the barrel. So.
These are still in the barrel. You're going to taste some older vintages.
Okay.
But what's neat is we get to see where they start, and then we get to see where they end up. And it's real neat.
Cool. Well,
let's go down and taste some wine.
Okay. Let's go. All right, Peter, what am I overlooking here?
This is our neighbor's vineyard. I'm not quite sure what the grapes are, the varietals, but it's just a pretty view.
It is a pretty view. You guys, I love it up here.
So do I. Cheers.
Keep coming back, right?
Every day.
Every day.
What we're trying here is this is the cook. This is an O2 cook.
Okay, again, this is the one with that ashy soil.
Volcanic ash, yeah. Charlie's Vineyard, the deep throat guy.
That's good stuff.
Isn't that tasty?
Nice color, too.
Yeah. So that's the cook.
Well, I felt bad you didn't keep spinning. Now I gotta do the same thing, you know?
No.
I like the wine, though.
Are you on your motorcycle today?
I am on my motorcycle.
Well, then you better start spinning.
That's right.
We're gonna have some of the bologna.
Bologna?
Bologna.
I never thought bologna went with wine before.
Well, it does now.
Wow.
Wine goes with just about everything now.
I can see that. Wine and bologna. Who'd have thought, Dan? Huh?
Now, actually, it's bellini.
Oh, bellini.
Bellini or bellone?
Bellone.
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 I think it's the beautiful one.
Yeah.
Are you Italian?
No. What are you going to do? Here's that.
Cheers.
Okay, so where does this one come from?
This is coming from Russian River. Russian River, is, as you know, is a cooler environment. Zin requires a lot of heat, so... This is generally one of the last vineyards we harvest. And typically, people will get pepper on this wine.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, though, it's got that... There is a sweetness to it, though.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the back there. That's really good.
Yeah.
You guys have so many Zinfandels. I'm in love.
We're in heaven.
Relax, Brent. You'll get your time. Oh, yeah, I forgot.
All right.
Sorry.
Now we're back to Joe Hooker's... I mean, sorry, the Barisha Vineyard. This is the one, the vineyard that was planted back in early 1890s.
So, and it's still producing?
Yeah, it is.
Are those big... thick vines that we see on
exactly,
the way
up. The big, fat, gnarly old vines.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they're twisted, and those are the babies, the 100-year-old vines.
That's crazy. We were talking at another winery, and they said they were opening a 100-year-old bottle of wine because they were destroyed in an earthquake in 1906.
Mm-hmm.
So it was 2006, so they opened a 100-year bottle of wine. It was still good.
Wow.
Yeah, can you believe that, 100 years?
That's pretty neat.
Yeah, that's pretty
neat. Did they share it with you?
That's
not pretty neat.
That's life, right?
Oh, well. Cheers.
Could be worse. Quite different. That's weird. It's smoother.
Yeah.
It's got a smooth finish to it.
Now, this wine's a little bit different. Barisha is made in the old style. It's called a field blend. And what they do is the Italians used to plant numerous varietals in the vineyard. In fact, we've got a vineyard down here on the way up the road that's got, you see fruit trees, and you've got table grapes planted out there and wine grapes. And so what they do is just harvest everything all at once, and that's the blend. Versus some of the other wines, we harvest the fruit all separate and figure out what our blend's gonna be.
Okay, so you're blending every one of these wines?
Generally.
Are these wines available to purchase?
They're tough to find.
They're tough to find.
The cook at 300 cases, it's pretty highly allocated if it even leaves here. Barisha and Bologna, you may see at some really good wine stores, but it's tough.
Can you buy it from here?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, we can help you buy anything.
Cheers to that.
Cheers to that. Well, of the 38 wines that we have, a lot of the wines we have, we only make 100 cases, and they're here only for a couple months. So if you do come up to the winery,
gives you ample opportunity to find some unique wines that we make.
Well, you heard it, folks. You gotta come up here to get the really special Ravenswood wine.
Right here.
Right here. Well, maybe not right here. You could go up to the wine
tasting room.
Yeah. But, hey, look. I see Bruce over there with this big bottle of wine.
And it's got your name on it.
It's got my name on it?
Yep.
Oh, cool. Come over here, Bruce.
Well, wine dude, good seeing you again. So how was that tasting with Peter?
It was awesome. You guys really make good wine.
This is the new. This is our newest wine. This is called Zen of Zin. You can see it's been supersized. This is a really large version. This is actually four bottles of wine in this big sucker.
Wow.
And
Zen of Zin.
You can feel it too.
Wow! Look at this, guys. Zen of Zin. That's a cool logo. I like what you guys did with that.
It's to appeal to a younger audience, the podcasters that you're going out to.
Okay, so you're telling me that this wine is specially made for the podcasters.
There you go.
You guys gotta come up here and try this stuff, Zen of Zin.
You really picked a great day to come up here. Look at this sunshine. It's just
beautiful
unreal
up here. I love this kind of weather. You guys, man.
Yeah.
I envy you. I noticed this big brown building here. What is that?
That's the old winery I mentioned to you. This goes back to 1860s. And if you look just to the right-hand side, just past that SUV, there's a pathway that goes up, and that was where horses could take the grapes when they were being delivered. They'd take them to the highest point, dump the grapes, and then their form of winemaking was by gravity, that it would then go by level to the lowest point. It was a winery until about 1900.
Okay.
Now you're supposed to say, well, why isn't it a winery anymore?
Well, why isn't it a winery anymore?
I think it got bad reviews.
And so Ravenswood took over.
No, it's owned by a guy that lives in the house, but he's actually one of our growers. The vineyard that you see right in front of you, most of it's ours, and then part of it is his, and then his goes up the hill and around. It's a nice little piece of the history of what we're all about.
When was that winery in operation?
About 1860-ish to 1900.
So it saw plenty of days, right? Jeez, guys are so picky.
Could be Buena Vista today.
That's true. That's true.
Yeah. We get about 40,000 visitors that come to visit us each year.
Mm-hmm.
Two-thirds of them are Ravenswood fans. They already consume Ravenswood wine. Men have actually come here before they check into the hotel.
Oh.
They'll come in, as you can see by our sign, we close at 5, there'll be people coming in today about 4:58, and they'll say, we just flew in from Boston or somewhere, and we really wanted to come and try your wines before we go to the hotel. So it puts us very much on the itinerary.
Yeah, plus we're gonna be able to get you out there to a lot more people,
well,
too.
And we certainly appreciate that.
Yeah.
But now we'll go into the Wine Dudes Bar, right?
Wine Dudes Bar, hey, I like this place.
These are the old doors from the original tasting room. This is what you're going to come into here now.
Beautiful. Nice knockers.
This was the only bar the Ravenswood had until the late 1990s when the bar behind us was expanded. We've retained this one to be what we call our vineyard designate bar. That's for when we want to showcase wines like this. I mean, this is the 2002 Todeschi from Dry Creek Valley, or the 2002 Bologna from Russian River Valley. So when you come here on weekends or by appointment, we have these wines available to taste, and you get a flight of 5 wines for $10. They're fabulous wines that range from $32 up to even $60 a bottle. Then we like to pour magnums. You can see the magnums behind us, because these are the library wines, these are the old vintages, and they're lots of fun. So
we got the whole crew here, so a Magnum might be okay.
Probably would be, yeah.
Talk to me about this logo.
This logo goes back to the origins of Ravenswood. And Joel Peterson, who you see in the photo over there, Joel started the winery 30 years ago. And in his first harvest, he actually made 327 cases.
In his first harvest?
In his first harvest.
Wow.
He had no name for the winery. So he was picking up his grapes in the vineyard. There was this ruckus behind him, and there were these ravens in the trees in this sort of stormy weather, sort of Edgar Allan Poe or kind of environment. And he was really concerned that these ravens were going to attack him. Well, they didn't, and he left, but he couldn't get these ravens out of his mind. They were kicking up a racket. And shortly after that, he went to an opera. The protagonist, his name is Lord Ravenswood. And the story in the opera is that Lord Ravenswood was a bad dude, and he killed everybody in this whole opera. The end, he fell off his horse, landed in quicksand. The opera ended when he was like up to his keister in quicksand. Joel went home, and that night had this experience that the ravens that were trying to attack me, then there's Lord Ravenswood up to here in quicksand. I feel like that sometimes trying to start a winery.
Right.
I'm going to call the winery Ravenswood. And then so now he had a name, but no logo. Chapinese restaurant in Berkeley. The artist who designed the Chapinese label, his name is David Lance Goines. And Joel approached him and said, I'd like you to design a label for Ravenswood. Part of the story that Joel tells is that initially he didn't want to do it because he's a card-carrying communist. And he couldn't do things for capitalistic purposes.
Right.
So Joel offered to pay him in wine, and in return, a label was created using the three ravens with the interlocking feet. And then with the ravens and the wood broken, and this has, in fact, been the same logo for 30 years.
That's great.
So it's
a cool logo.
It's a really great logo. We should mention our famous cat, Clackamas. Okay. Clackamas was delivered to Ravenswood after the initial cat disappeared after, like, 15 years. This couple came in looking for the original cat. I think the original cat's name was Cat, so it was a real unusual name. 2 or 3 weeks after this couple had left, this package arrived, special delivery, by a courier. In it was a little kitten, and it came from Clackamas County in Oregon. And so that's when we signed for it, whoever delivered it. And so Clackamas, who's about 13 or 14 years of age now, she is like the Duchess of Ravenswood. I mean, so she has a special place here, and we may see her in her walkabout.
She's the queen of the castle.
She's the queen of the castle.
All right, cool.
She's the boss. I'd like you to meet George. You're here on Thursday, and George Becker, who's right here, has been with Ravenswood for a long time on Thursdays. And I'll tell you a quick funny story.
Wine dude.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah.
When I first started here just over 2 years ago, I've been here about a month, and I was walking around in the back, and there's this guy walking around picking up bottles of wine. I thought, who is that? And he came up and said, I'm George, how are you? And George had been on vacation, so he just happened to come back on that day. So without further ado, here's George.
Hey, well, if you want to go into the history of this organization, you know, pre-boss, I'd be glad to tell you anything you'd like to know. How about the story of how Ravenswood got its name?
Okay, I think we heard that from Bruce.
We did, but you'll, really you'll get the real story.
Whom did you hear this from?
I
heard
from
it
Joel.
From whom? Joel, yeah. This is perfect. You've heard Joel's thing about I was out there picking grapes, the storm clouds were coming in. From across the vineyard, a chorus of ravens started cawing as if to say, you're a fool for ever getting in the wine business. Is that the story he told you?
It's kind of like that, maybe varied a little.
Well, the fact is that ravens don't go in flocks. They go in pairs or singly. And I really believe that it was crows. Now, they may have been saying that to him, and maybe not. But my thought is, since Joel's mom was an English teacher, and Sir Walter Scott was one of her authors, he wrote a book called The Bride of Lammermoor, and in there was a character named Lord Ravenswood, who had an unfortunate encounter with a quicksand bog, and as he was sinking slowly up to his mouth, perhaps he could have said, you're a fool for getting in the wine business, but Joel, I've talked to him about that, and he has said, basically, don't you think I know the difference between a crow and a raven? And since he's my superior, far be it for me to say, no, I don't think you know what's the difference between a crow and a raven. But there are a lot
Plus,
of...
crow's wood is not as good as raven's
Right, crow's wood just doesn't work, does it?
Nah, not like raven's wood. No.
That's about it.
That's about it.
Altogether, we make about 40 different wines. We said there's like 14 different Zinfandels.
Right.
So there's a lot of other wines. The first one here, this is the Rosato. This is a real nice dry rosé, great picnic wine. Only sold here. It's only sold here in the spring and will be gone probably 2-3 months.
Oh, okay.
And this is made from a blend of Zinfandel with Lord Carignan and Grenache. This is a very nice wine. And it sells for $17 a bottle. It's a nice price. It has a really nice nose and it's just really refreshing.
I like it.
Yeah, it's good.
I like it because it's not real sweet. Mmm. Very good.
I showed you the very large bottle of Zinfandels earlier. So this is the...
The one with my name on it?
The one with your name on it. This is actually the one with your name on it.
Oh, that's the one with my name. But it's almost empty.
There's enough for you.
Okay.
This is, I mentioned earlier, we made this specifically for a younger audience. And we went out and did all kind of focus group testing and had them taste wines. And the end result was that this is a wine that they really liked. So it's a blend from Lodi, Amador up in the High Sierras, mm-hmm. and Mendocino, which is north of us, which is a pretty cool, much cooler climate. And it's all old vine, which means they're all more than 60 years old. So even though we're going to a younger audience, we know that they're also a wine appreciation audience where they do care what it is that they're drinking. So this is, you have to pretend you're in that 22 to 30 demographic now.
What do you mean pretend?
Can you do that?
Oh, that smells good.
It's nice.
Definitely different from all your other zins.
We think this will be an everyday wine.
Right. Yeah, that's what it reminds me of, an everyday wine. Mm-hmm. I see what you mean.
The flagship of Ravenswood. If you see ads, they'll typically have the Sonoma County Zinfandel. This sort of typifies who we are. We're here in Sonoma County, and this is from about 8 vineyards throughout the county. So the benefit with this is we get fruit from Russian River, Alexander Valley, Sonoma Valley. They're all blended together, and you had the individual vineyards.
Right.
So you can then experience what, when we blend from all of those appellations, and we get the Sonoma County Zinfandel. We do add a little Petit Sirah and Carignan.
Okay.
Petit Sirah adds sort of a lot of color, and Carignan has some spice, but it also adds a little balance to the Zinfandel.
The Carignan is something you don't normally hear of.
You don't. I mean,
mostly in blending.
It's mainly a blending grape, but we do sell it just by itself. We make a little bit, and people that sample it say, wow, this is a really nice wine. It's a nice food wine.
Yeah, it's got a dryness to it, too.
The next one we have is this is our Estate Merlot. For your podcasters who may not know what estate means, that if it has the term estate, that means that the vineyard is located on the same property as the winery. So this is a legal definition.
Okay.
And so if you own the vineyards and they were just down the road or 5 miles away, they cannot be estate. That would be proprietors grown.
Right, so the grapes basically don't leave the site.
Correct.
They go from the vineyard on site.
They go right from here to the winery.
The winery, okay.
And this is a very small production wine. Earlier I'd shown you on the back of these very small production wines, we still have the birth certificate. When the grapes were harvested, when we bottled the wine, and in this case we made 550 cases. So that's a very small production.
That's cool, though, that you have that on there. All your wines have that?
No.
Well, let's check it out.
Merlot's got a bad rap at the Sideways movie.
Yeah. And, you know what? We've been on a whole mission. We're telling everybody, give us your Merlot. We love Merlot. Yeah. Merlot's not a bad wine. I'm not trying to slam anything with the Sideways movie, but just because he said, I'm not drinking any Merlot.
Any bleep bleep Merlot.
Well, I know.
Try it, and if you like it, then you don't have to believe everything in a movie.
Well, that's what we are telling people. Like what you drink and drink what you like.
Absolutely.
The good thing about your winery, you got so many different wines that someone's gonna come here and it doesn't matter what it is they like, whether it's the Rosato or one of your high-end Zins, they're gonna find something they like. And that's something I'm trying to get across to people.
Sure. You really enjoy wine tasting. Your husband or significant other may like this wine, but they might not like the one you like. So you need to be able to enjoy it for yourself.
If you like a wine with a particular food, that's what you should say.
Yeah.
There's no rule that says you shouldn't have this with that. I mean, if that's what you like.
And one of the chefs that we interviewed has told us that in many cases, he doesn't compare the wine to the food, right? Mm-hmm. He drinks the wine first and says, what would go good with this?
Yeah.
A lot of chefs do it the other way around.
Yeah.
You know, here's the food, oh, we'll try this wine with it. No, he doesn't do it that way. And I think that's a great way to do it. That was really good. It's like a mellow Merlot, but it's got a spice to it too.
It's nice. So it's just grown right over here.
That's great.
This is the 2003 Petite Syrah. Again, this is a county wine, sells for $18 a bottle, and we made a giant 250 cases. This is not very much.
Wow.
Because the bulk of the Petite Syrah goes into the blending, you know, with the Zinfandel.
And the Petite Syrah and Syrah are two different grapes.
They're cousins. Is what they are.
Okay.
And this is a, as you can see by the color, is really bold and intense. I think it's become a bit of a cult wine. I think there are a lot of people that really seek out Petit Syrahs and they like to sort of compare them to a Syrah Shiraz.
When we looked it up to see the difference, because we couldn't figure out why there was two different spellings. It's like, well, that's because it's not the same grape.
Yeah, it's not the same grape.
Period. I do know that the Petit Syrahs are all very dark.
They're very intense.
Yeah.
Yep. So don't spill it on your white shirt, because otherwise you'll have a problem getting the wine scent out.
Well, yeah, that, and also, I don't know if you looked at this shirt, you can see it's sure a wine.
You've been wine tasting.
Just a little, yeah. These wines that you're trying with us here, are they available?
The only one you can currently buy in the stores is the McKenna Zinfandel.
Okay.
The Zen of Zin, this will be available in the fall. But the other wines are, you have to come and see us. Of course, when you come and see us, we've always got other wines tucked behind. Even though the list will say one thing, there'll always be two or three wines that we don't say, they're not on the list, because we like to keep those in as a surprise.
As a surprise, okay.
Because we want you to be caught off guard, and then you experiment and you begin to realize that, hey, there are other wines to try. This is the Mother's Day favorite. All the guys will taste Moscato, and then they'll say, oh, lovely, I'll buy this for my mother, my wife, my girlfriend, my sister, my daughter. It's never apparently for them. Mm. So we sort of wonder about, you know, why is that?
It's so, chick wine.
It's, but it's, this is really nice. It has, it's fairly low alcohol, it's 7%. It has a little effervescence, as you can see, which the French call a fraisance wine.
Oh, it smells
and
good.
And when it's, before we bottle it, we blanket the holding tank with carbon dioxide, which gets absorbed into the wine. We bottle it chilled, so when we get them, it appears to be slightly fizzy, a bit like a cider. It's not a sparkling wine like a champagne, but it has just enough in it to just give it a little bit of fun.
Yeah, and it's, I smell a lot of
beautiful,
like honey,
honeysuckle,
floral.
And it's a nice dessert wine, or you could have it for brunch. You know,
that's so good.
Back home when you're out there on the porch in Simi Valley on a Sunday, you could have your pancakes and French toast and a little Moscato.
How's it with Cheerios?
Maybe.
Okay. Might work, huh? We've had other wines compared to Cheerios.
Maybe the honey nut ones.
Yeah, there you go. That was very good. Very good. I like that one.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed your visit here today.
We've had a great time.
You've had a little bit of the history. You met some of the people here. Enjoyed the wines out of the barrel, often the same vineyard, out of the bowl. And then these selections. And, of course, George is an amazing character with his, and he is part of the lifeblood and folklore of Ravenswood.
Right. So you guys, if you want to meet George, you got to come up here on a Thursday, correct?
Only Thursdays, yeah.
Okay, and these wines here that we've tasted,
You can only get them here. As Bruce said, you can only buy one at the Sonoma County Zin.
Of these wines in here, we want you to try wines that show the bread and the capabilities of our winemaking team.
Mm-hmm. You've got, what's the racer's name?
We have David Green, number 27 in NASCAR.
27 NASCAR.
So they're flying the NASCAR series this year.
Sponsoring two
and
Ferraris.
And two Ferraris, which is the Joel Quaid. And Joel Quaid is from Santa Barbara. He and his son are racing in the Ferrari Challenge series.
Very cool. This is a great winery. This place is really cool. You gotta come here, check out all these different wines. We've had a wonderful time here. It's a beautiful place. It's tucked up here in the hills. And they got this big old tasting room here. It was full of people. We had to like kick them out in order to get our interview, but it worked. Really nice people who work here. Bruce, I want to thank you again.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, and we'll be bringing a lot of people here.
Well, I certainly appreciate that, and we look forward to seeing them.
Great. I love these Zinfandels. We're here at Ravenswood Winery. As you see, they have a huge selection of wine here, over 40 wines. The only place you can taste these wines and get these wines are here at this winery, Ravenswood, up in Sonoma Valley. Beautiful place, tucked away. They got flowers, they got a place to eat barbecue, they got all kinds of events. They're even sponsoring NASCAR. And two Ferraris in local races. Unbelievable. What a great winery. You guys gotta come here and check it out. And come with me, the Wine Dude, tasting as you go.
Here giving you directions to Ravenswood Winery in Sonoma Valley, California. Now listen carefully because this place is tucked way up in the hills of Sonoma. Okay, ready? Okay, here we go. From San Francisco, take the 101 north to Highway 37 towards Napa. Take Highway 121 north onto Arnold Drive, Carneros Highway, towards Sonoma, Napa. Follow Arnold Drive. Turn right onto Watma Road. Turn left onto Broadway, Highway 12. Right onto East Napa Street. Left onto 4th Street East. Right onto Brazil Street. Left onto Garrick Road. Look for the sign with the three ravens on it, and you're there. Go on in and try their Zinfandels. They're awesome. Well, there you have it. Thanks for joining us at Ravenswood Winery, our next official Wine Dude podcast. I want to thank Bruce McKay, Peter Griffith, George Becker, and Tanya Parmalee for all of their time and hospitality. I'd especially like to thank Joel Peterson for his incredibly awesome wines, especially the Zinfandels. You can find Ravenswood on the web at www.ravenswood-wine.com. And remember, to err is human, but to Zin is divine. And here at Ravenswood lies the last wimpy wine. Check out our website at www.thewinedude.com. Take our survey. Download our podcast. Write a review on iTunes. Tell your friends about our show and help us put The Wine Dude on network television. Get some great info on California wines and wineries. Also, look for The Wine Dude's Upside Down Tour and join us for a weekend of tasting.
There's the wine tasting room. We're tasting here on the Upside Down Tour. Tasting as you go. Come on, let's go, quickly, before we fall.
Trust me, you won't be disappointed. But most of all, drink what you like what you drink. Don't let anybody tell you what's good or bad. Trust your own palate, and most of all, have fun. And join me, the Wine Dude, tasting as you go.